Well, we're back on the Land Rover and I've just fitted a P-clip to the oil pressure capillary line just there, which is kind of the final job with that, and check for leaks after last weekend's run. No leaks at all oil tight. While I'm here, I'm just going to make a note of some little things that I want to attend to soon, like the starter motor cable is not very nice and the way it's secured is less than ideal, and things like the vacuum advance pipe, I'd like to do that in copper and find a better way to secure it, all things like that that I can improve, but we can come back to. So I think I'm about ready to put the driver's side wing back on. I was going to give a coat of bitumen underseal on the footwell, but to be honest, for the time being, I think I'm actually going to leave it. I'm not intending to use the vehicle in winter too much anymore, so I think it'll be okay. But it's something that I can come back to, even once it's all put back together. This is the driver's side wing off the Series 3. It had quite a lot of damage, things like this return edge all beaten over, completely flattened. I've managed to straighten it all out quite a bit. And found what looks like a bullet hole as well up through there, which is interesting. It had a big split through there where the wing top mounts to the bulkhead, so I've just put a reinforcing plate on the inside. I think I really need to replace this wing at some point. New fastenings here. I'm not going to do anything about all this for now, but I have cleaned it up and straightened it out quite a bit. I've also put a reinforcing plate under there, riveted in Sikaflex, keeping that on there. There you are, she's getting her face back. The wing has all been put on with stainless bolts, which will just help the next time I need to get it off. Managed to get it to fit reasonably well, not quite rigid as well. Yeah, it looks a lot better under there, that's for sure. I'm just about to fit a galvanised mud shield and a steering box cover. You can see the little repair bracket doing its job up there. Bit ugly, but it works. All the wing bolts in with nice new washers. I'm about to put some spacers in here between the mud shield and the footwell, just so that any water and dirt that wants to collect in there can't, it can just come past the mud shield. I spent a bit of time straightening the wing out. All this edge was bent over and that bracket was really beaten up, so everything is just fitted straight into place just as it should. Time well spent. Stainless bolts up the front, and I'll thread the cable through last. So the mud shield's going in. It's an aftermarket part, so naturally didn't fit very well. I'd quite like to get some washers on the top there, but I can't take them out now. Looks like a little ping out of place. I'll have to take it off and paint it now at some point in the future, because I had to extend that cutout for the steering box. It simply didn't fit. Really annoying. I'm about to put the bolts in at the bottom, and I've got some Delrin spacers to go in between the bulkhead and the mud shield, which I'll show you. So I turn these up. A few months ago now, they're Delrin or acetol, I think it is, but anyway, they will just space the mud shield out that much, about 3/8 from the bulkhead, and allow any water that gets up there to be washed away, or any detritus and so on, leaves, what have you, easy to hose out. So there we are, the driver's side mud shield is in, and you can see that the dowing spacers are doing their job. I can just get my little finger up behind that panel so dirt and water can get by it. Yeah, it's not fitted up too bad in the end, bit of a struggle, but we got there. So there we are, once again the daylight has beaten me. I haven't had a chance to hook up the headlamps, but that's the next job. But all looking very much better. The wiring all looks so much tidier. I may have to turn those P-clips upside down to clear the battery clamp, I'm not sure about that yet. Let's go around the other side. What is kind of annoying is that I've just spotted a bit of a leak from the bypass hose, top and bottom. So I think I'm going to get one of those. I'll probably take off the top part that connects to the thermostat housing and do the thermostat while I'm in there, because I think that needs changing. So, another job to do. I'm just doing a bit more wiring, tidying. The wiring under the front panel was a bit of a rat's nest, especially as I've got the electric fan. Never mind the colour codes, but I've got some proper Lucas bullet connectors on there now, rather than crimps. You've got the same for the headlight connections, I did that a while ago. And I've run as much of it as possible in conduit, which will all be held up with rubberized P-clips. So all nice and safe and a hell of a lot tidier. Proof that you can have a Leyland era vehicle with reasonably tidy wiring. It's quite a lot better than it was. You can see that the headlight connections are easily accessible. Only two P-clips required now, it's all in conduit, they're a bit stronger. And yeah, it should actually be quite discreet once the radiator grille is fitted. The grille tends to sort of cover that area there. So it should be quite good. Main thing is it's all better protected, so it's all a little bit safer. But the important connections I might want to remove are still all accessible. And when I eventually get to changing this rotten front panel or repairing it, it's not too bad, but it's not great, then it'll make it a little bit easier. Battery back in. I'm not entirely happy with the clamp, which has a tendency to try and pop off the top of the battery. Might have to look at that. It's pretty good. I can't move it, but I'll keep an eye on it. Either way, I think it's quite safe. It's all well insulated now. I've got one of these removable. Terminals. Yeah, all quite neat and tidy. I'm very pleased with that. So I think we can actually put the radiator grill back on now. Not dark enough to see the instruments illuminated yet, apart from the oil pressure gauge, which, as you can see, illuminates well. Martin, you were dead right about the light creeping around the back. That'll annoy me forever. Never mind. Anyway, on the whole, I think that's gone quite well. Hi folks, welcome back to the workshop. I think last time we got the front end of the Land Rover back together. I think initially I showed you this little list of works that I'd come up with for this job, and I thought we'd just have a bit of a sort of status update, you know, where we've got to. It's quite nice having a list that you can tick bits off. In this case, it looks like there's still the bulk of it to do, but that's not really quite true. So what have we done? We've rebuilt the master cylinder brake pedal tower. We've removed and rebuilt the steering box and restored the bulkhead on that side as best as possible. We've replaced the battery cables. We've improved the wiring to the electric cooling fan. We had all the dashboard out in the course of the steering box works, and we put in some new sockets and had a general bit of a wiring tidy. We fitted an oil pressure gauge, the extra bits aren't on the list. And then we put it all back together, checked the operation of the lights, I think that was last time, and we're now ready to move on. So we've got check over brake pipe work, and I noted particularly the front cross member, I noted a bit of rust on one of those. Yeah, we're halfway through that. I've still got the rear brake pipe to the back axle to make. I've been putting that off, to be honest. But there is another one that runs across the back axle that I still need to make, so I think that's a good excuse. We'll come back to that. But next on the list is to strip down the rear brakes. Why start with the rear? Well, on my 109 you've got twin leading shoe front brakes, and they're notorious for being difficult to bleed up. A lot of people recommend taking the back plates off, flipping them horizontal, and then you can bleed the system through a lot easier like that. I know, having done it in the past, it's very difficult, and having completely drained and repiped the system could be fun. So yeah, we're going to remove the rear brake back plates. Well, I might leave the back plates in situ actually and rebuild them on the car, but we'll see. We'll do all that, get it back together, wheels on, and then that avoids having the car on four axle stands, which I try and avoid doing. It's just safer keeping at least one axle with wheels on it. Yeah, we'll go from there. So that's where we are. Rear brakes first, and then we'll move to the front. The front will be a lot more involved. It's quite a lot of work to do there. I think the last time I identified a couple of other things I wasn't happy with in the engine bay, one of which was the vacuum pipe. So I've managed to get the proper fittings for that, the P-clip and copper pipe. It's all in plastic at the moment and it just looks a bit naff, and it's not necessarily the most sturdy thing. I've also got a new bypass pipe for the water pump, as that appears to be leaking. So yeah, plenty to do. Best get on with it really. Here we are, not too shabby. And near side rear brakes. You can see a roadside repair from some years ago, but it's held up. I've just marked all the spring positions. These brake shoes have got about 65,000 miles on them. So there we are, we went the whole hog this side in the end. Quite a bit of rust in the axle case. There was a huge amount of rust, like a quarter inch deep, sitting in the bottom at the end, but it hadn't got anywhere near the diff. I've never seen anything like it in the oil, so I think it was just sitting in there. But if I shone a light up in there, you'd see loads more sort of oily rusticles at the top of the axle tube, which is a bit nasty, so I've got to work out a way of cleaning that out without getting it all in the diff. I'm just on the other side. It all came apart quite easily this side. I was only going to do the one today. Might as well get both sides apart, and then we'll hopefully get that brake pipe off as well and get those made up. Just had a little look around while I'm under here. Things like the exhaust rubbers and spring bushes,
gaiters and so on, all really good.
I'll try and give it all a bit of a clean up under there as well. I haven't really found anything amiss so far. I'll show you inside the wheel cylinders. They are a bit grotty, but the only thing is these drive flanges are showing a bit of wear now, which will contribute to the slop in the drive line. There's actually a few degrees of rotation before they take up, so I think I might just get some new ones. They're cheap enough, but yeah, I'm not heavy on the brakes, as you can see. Yeah, 65,000 miles, maybe a bit more on these. It's done fairly well. Just marked up the position of the springs. I've never really sussed the technique for getting the shoes on and off. It's a pretty horrible job. But what I have found is that you can actually punch the springs back through the brake shoe. So you can get the top one off. And I found it's a lot easier to prise the bottom of the shoes away from the back plate. That's how I did the other side. It seems to work. Well, nothing too challenging there. I punched the springs out, as I said, or the top spring from the brake shoes, and then was able to remove the other two with the lower spring still attached. These later Series 3s, built after 1980, they've got a different stow axle with this collar built in. They use a different hub seal. The one people are always telling me is fitted backwards, it isn't. They've got a little catcher to catch oil leaks. These cylinders, both sides are the same, they're quite pitted inside. But the seals are perfectly good. Bought quite easily. It's taken me about 40 minutes to do that. But yeah, look at the gunge in there. It doesn't appear to have got in the diff, because I never see any of that in the oil, and I've never seen anything like that when the pan's been taken off. But yeah, it's pretty grim. So I think I'm gonna have to try and, I reckon, some long small bottle brushes, and I can put them in there and then pull them back this way. But they've got to be well under size of the bore, so I don't push the grot back into the diff. I think we can make that a lot better. But yeah, not very nice. Kind of surprised, actually. Well, I just got in there with the crowbar and raked that lot out. Absolutely grim. I think a lot of that is just mud as well. Yeah, I definitely have to do something about that, clean it out properly. Might take the diff pan off as well and just have a nosy in there. There we are, both sides stripped down with the brake pipes removed. So the next thing is to give it all a bit of a clean up under here. And I think I'd like to get another coat of wax oil on the axle case, clean all that out, and make up those brake pipes. That'll do for today, I think. Just filled up the parts washer with all the bits from the offside brake assembly. I thought we'd just have a quick look at the cylinders. This one is really much the same as the other side. One free cylinder, one stuck pretty solid. Yeah, it's sticky pistons all round, it would seem. But what is encouraging is that the seals inside, which frankly I expected to find worn and perished, are really nice. I think these were Delphi cylinders. They weren't the cheapest, they were kind of middle of the road, but I mean, to be perfectly honest, if somebody sent that to me in a nice little plastic bag as a brand new one, I think I might struggle to tell the difference. The boots are a bit worse for wear, and the pistons have corroded. But the bores of the cylinders are worse. To be fair, you could probably hone these out and use them again. But anyway, nice new ones to fit. What I am going to do this time though is pack a bit of grease in the back there. You know, Castrol red rubber grease in there, just to sweeten it up a bit. The other one's much the same, not very nice really. But yeah, they've done their time. Hi folks, well, we're back on the brakes. It's taken a long time to get to doing the brakes, which is kind of the subject of this series of videos. I should have probably called it the winter overhaul or roverhaul, just because we've gone much further with it than I ever intended, really. But it's not a bad thing. I've got all these parts cleaned up. They were a bit rusty, so that's all dealt with. It's important to note there are some differences between earlier and later Land Rovers. Pre-1980 the axles are a bit different. So these stub axles are one piece and they've got these oil catcher rings, which allow, if the hubs leak or the wheel cylinders leak, the idea is that it can get down through that little hole via the oil catcher and out of that gap, which you can see behind the brake back plate. So if that gets wet, you know you've got trouble. My new boss very kindly let me put the back plates through the blaster. They've come up really nice. You can see how rusty they were. So that saved me a lot of trouble. And we'll probably give those another coat of paint, at least on that side, once they're put together. I'm intending to put the shoes on, shoes and springs on the bench, just to save myself a bit of trouble. And it's a bit more pleasant in here. It's important to get the orientation of the brake shoes right, so I marked mine up as I knew that these were actually correct. In this case, this one here and this one here, left and right, these are the leading shoes, these here are the trailing shoes. So how do we identify which is which? So the leading shoes have these holes here close together than the trailing shoes. So that's a leading shoe, that's a leading shoe, and these two are the trailing ones. The holes down the bottom appear to be much the same. It's worth noting that Mintex seem to have riveted these little adjuster pins in much better. There was a problem back in about 2013 or 14 with defective Mintex brake shoes, and you can see that mine were among the affected batch. These hideous welds were done at the roadside, basically far from home. I knew somebody that I could call on, and we tacked them in place on the pavement outside with a welder running off an extension reel. Got me home though, and lasted another few years. I'd just forgotten about them, really. Anyway, that's what that was all about. I don't think we're going to have any trouble with these new ones. These bits all came from a Paddock Spears brake rebuild kit, and I'm pleased to say they're not supplying the cheapest parts possible. They're supplying some quite decent stuff. The Mintex shoes are supposed to be good quality, as are these TRW brake cylinders. They're not the cheapest, they're sort of middle of the road. Yeah, I'm quite happy with that, and they represented quite a good value, I thought. So we'll see what it's all like. It's important to note as well, you've got left and right hand cylinders. On this vehicle we've got all metric brake lines, however the ports in the cylinders are imperial, so we've got to make some suitable pipes up. Anyway, I'm going to mock these up with the spring positions and hopefully get them put together. Having just mocked up the shoes with the spring positions, it occurred to me that actually not all Land Rovers are created equal, and there are a few variations of spring positions and types. So if you've got a 6-pot Land Rover or a V8 Stage 1, or indeed an 88, there are quite a few variations. So it's one of those things, it's easy to come unstuck. So please don't just follow my video, go and do your research, get the manual, and you will see some of the differences given in there. But it's worth doing your homework. I think the best advice I can give is have a look at the LR Workshops website. All the parts diagrams are on there if you don't have the parts book, and it gives you a good key as to what models have what brake shoes and so on. It's worth spending a bit of time on. Well, that wasn't a great deal of fun. The new springs were no good at all, so I've ended up using the old ones again with a little blast of paint to tidy them up. What a challenge that was. I located the shoes on the cylinder, and then you're supposed to try and snap them in at the bottom. Well, actually getting them either side of this post here is a lot easier said than done, and I ended up fixing the back plate up in the vise to get enough leverage to open that very heavy spring up. Yeah, not a lot of fun. Only just managed to do it, really, so it might just be easier to put the shoes on the vehicle, but either way, it's done now. And I can see that it's all going to fit up okay. There's still room to get a socket on the bolts and so on. Yeah, it's going to be fine. Yeah, next one. Joy. Well, I'm not going to film myself battling with these, but having done the first one, hopefully this one might be a little easier. Anyway, just to give you an idea of how I've gone about with this. Having fitted the cylinder, which I've put some red rubber grease behind the boots. I've just prized them back, and show you. This is the stuff, Castrol red rubber grease, and a little bit of that Ceratec brake grease stuff, really meant for disc brakes, but I've just put that where the shoes run in the cylinder, the end of the pistons, and in this block here, which will just give them a bit of lubrication until it's all settled in. And likewise, there's a little sort of punched raised point that the shoe sits against on the back plate, a little pressing, and I'll put a drop on there. Now the springs, I've hooked both springs on, and then by hand you can very easily locate the ends of the shoes in the cylinder. We're then going to prise one end in, and then I'm going to put the back plate back up in the vise again, so I can get a real bit of leverage on it. What I did last time was to get just a big screwdriver under there, holding against it and levering. A bit dodgy, but it snapped on all right. Those brake shoe pliers, absolutely useless, so I'm glad they were only very cheap. Anyway, let's see how long this one takes. There we are, the second one was all done in about 5 minutes, so I don't know what the struggle was with the first one, really. Just finding the technique, I think. Not something I do every day. Anyway, I'm quite pleased with how they've turned out. I might actually give them another blast of paint before I fit them, just for a bit more protection. Once it's all back together, I think the axle will get wax oiled, but I'm going to wait until the warmer weather to do that. Anyway, that's worked out reasonably well. Just give them the hubs a check over. I'm not going to go mad with these. I'm going to get them back together, give them a blast of paint. I repacked these, well, I fitted new wheel bearings and repacked them with grease about this time last year, and they haven't done a lot of miles since. The grease is all still clean in this one, but oily in the other. But I'm just going to change the seal. So I've just packed a bit more fresh grease into the bearing and left it alone, really. These, as I say, you know, there are differences with the axles pre and post 1980. This is a post 1980 axle. You can see it's got 130 studs in it for my Wolf wheels, which are a bit different. But yeah, it's a post 1980 hub, so it's got a different seal. I believe the earlier ones, the seals go the other way round. Everybody's always telling me on my wheel bearing video that these are the wrong way round. That is correct. for a late model series 3. So we'll push that in, and it's got to be recessed about 5mm from this face. And to do that, I've got an old wheel bearing which is used as a fitting tool, and that block which I can hit with a hammer if need be. Equally, you can do it on a press if you've got one. The hubs have had a little bit of a tidy up, just a blast of paint really, and the bearings packed with grease, and I've changed the seals for the off-shelf caps. Hopefully they'll do another couple of years. Well, the weather's a bit nasty, so I think that's as far as we go today. Be nice to get some bits and pieces back on there. It's all pretty well ready now, and the rear brake pipes here are made up. Metric fittings for the T-piece, imperial for the wheel cylinders. Kind of bad practice to mix types of fitting on the same line, but it comes down to the wheel cylinders we can get. We have our first compatibility issue, however. This is a flexible hose from the line that runs along the chassis to the back axle and then goes to the T-piece on the axle case. And you'll notice that the end fitting on the new one is quite different. Now, I do think that the T-piece might have been changed. Last time the brakes were done, these braided flexes were fitted. They were from a Britpot kit, and it's possible that that fitting was not right for the year, and that T-piece could well have got changed because the rest of that lot got changed at the same time. I have found that there is a specific T-piece listed which also serves Discoveries and Range Rovers and so on, which appears different on this port. You'll notice that they're all the same. So if we can, well, I have ordered one, but if we find that it has the right fitting in there, we can then use the Goodrich hose, which I'd really like. Otherwise, I found there's another type of 109 metric hose with that fitting. So it's possible that either is correct for the application with the right parts to fit it. Yeah, it's a bit of a minefield, isn't it? So we'll find out next time anyway. I think that'll be it for now. Thanks very much for watching, and we'll see you next time. So when we left off last time, I wasn't sure about these brake pipes. I've gone away and studied the parts books and so on, and it turns out I had got all the right bits. It was just that the wrong bits were previously fitted. It all worked, but it was that kind of fitting, and it shouldn't be that for the model year. It should be this kind of fitting. And of course we discover that, as with all things Land Rover, there's a multitude of different ways of doing the same thing. And earlier Land Rovers sometimes have that type of fitting. Sometimes they have one like this, but with a crush washer between the fitting and the T-piece, and that does the sealing. In this case, this type of fitting is just an interference on the bottom of the T-piece. There's a little taper there, which I just put some marker pen on and wound in, and it left a nice witness mark. The two angles are slightly different, so it will really bite into that when tightened down, and it will leave a little gap between the hex and that shoulder, and that's quite correct for my year of vehicle. So nice to settle that one. I'll be happy fitting those bits now. Not a lot else to report really. The weather's been too horrible, and another storm due through this weekend, so I haven't been able to refit all the bits that I've restored. But I have got on with my winch. Wasn't intending to do anything with this for the time being, but there's nothing really wrong with it. Nothing that we couldn't put right easily. The housing's got to be cleaned up, along with the winch bollard. But we've got some new bearings and seals in there. All new hardware. Managed to get a replacement base plate to replace the horrible homemade stainless one. All the important bits, this gear and this shaft and gear, are kind of the bits that could write off your winch project, but all of that's in really good shape. These bits here are new. You can see the kind of state that some of this was in. This This here is probably the worst bit to have to replace. It's about 150 quid, I think, if you've got to replace that shaft, which is available new. Even that joint is about 80, so quite expensive. So I really wanted to salvage that. So that's soaked in phosphoric acid for a week or so, which ate away all the rust. This joint has even come up really well. There's no slack in it. I'm sure it won't last as long as a nice new one. But yeah, it'll be fine. The bit I couldn't save was the pin through the end here, which engages with that dog on the crankshaft. It was really chewed up, so I've made this new one out of EN16, and what it is just an 8mm pin, two washers, the ends riveted over, and then you've got these little bearings here, which are just a free fit on the pin. So very simple, easily made. Being EN16, the hard part is riveting it over. Anyway, that's salvaged and saved me a lot of money, so it should remain a bargain winch. Next thing is to clean up that housing, and actually we can put it back together again. Well, Storm Eunice swept through. We had 90-100 mile an hour winds down here. Bit of a mess outside, but the workshop fortunately has survived, and long may it continue to do so. The winch case is back from vapor blasting, and it looks so much better. I've just assembled the cleaned up shaft and bearings in tonight. It's not perfect, there's quite a bit of pitting on it, but it's perfectly serviceable. I think, excuse me, the seals will do their job. Two new bearings, all new seals. There's actually two seals in either end. And this big nut here, you might be able to see it there. I've made a special spanner for that, which I made last time around. Always pays to make those sort of tools, I find. And you heat this end of the housing up with the shaft in place, pop the bearing in, and it will just slide in and out while it's hot. And you can just wind that nut up until you feel the end float on that gear just taken up. I then tend to knock it back so that I've just got the slightest little bit of end float when it's hot. And as you can see, it's all nice and free, even now it's cooled down, but there's no perceivable end float. So that means that the bearings will turn and not be skipping on the races. All like bushes, I've pressed them back in. They've been soaking in oil for a few days. All new fixings, easier just to replace them. There's the winch attached to the base plate. Ended up using stainless bolts. They were what I had that was the right length. The black ones were just slightly too short. I had to use two black ones there, but I think it looks alright. Reasonably smart. Got the sort of selector mechanism in. New thrust washers. Just drove the roll pin in there. Need to cut that off, and I'm about ready to make my pivot pin now. Yeah, it's gone rather well. I think it's actually going to be quite nice considering what I started with. Well, we're doing this the traditional way this evening. Just serviced the bioladding paraffin lamp, so yeah, why not? Just cleaned up the axle tube. The other side's actually all together. I put the brake pipes on the other day and a new axle breather. You might just see glowing there in the light. So I've cleaned out the axle tube with some bottle brushes best I can, and I'll drop the diff oil, change that. These gaskets supplied are too big. They'll work on the front but not on the back. So what I'm going to do is pin that on there with the bolts and then tap around the edge with a hammer. Cut the gasket to size, it'll work very nicely on the other side, and then we'll get it all together. Well, that's it, I'm ready to put this side together. I've got the stub axle, got plenty of RTV sealant on it, on there as well. Don't normally like it, but on this kind of thing it's quite good. One to remember, RTV on the oil catcher ring if you have that. Not all of them do.
Just see the oil drain cut out, that needs to go at the bottom.
At the brake back plate, you'll see a little hole just there that lines up with the cutout in the stow axle. Where we'll end this one. Brake pipes connected up, all torqued up. I'm just going to grease that stow axle now so it doesn't go rusty, and then bag up the brake back plate, keep the weather out, hopefully get the hubs on at the weekend. Well, I suspect by now it's ended up a rather long video, but we'll finish up with the winch again. Hopefully next time I'll be stripping down the front brakes and swivel units. Done a bit more on the winch over the last couple of days. All that really remains is to strip and paint these bits. This lever was missing when I got it. I managed to obtain one of those. You can still buy them. The stud that that pivots on was missing. It was a bit of all thread, the sort of thing that builders use. So we've made a proper thing for that and tapped the housing out with a threaded strip. That had an M6 coach screw smashed through it, just hammered through to keep it in place. So it's now been drilled out and a proper, oversized roll pin fitted. The crankstart dog was missing and I couldn't find the correct one. So it occurred to me that all I actually needed was a crankstart dog off an engine. And all I had to do was then cut the thread off the back. Now, I found this one on eBay. Amazingly, when it turned up, it's a metric thread. And the metric ones you can never find if you want one. Anyway, I've got two now, so I could cut this one up. It's got a M16? 16 TPI by 3/4 inch thread, which I think is a UNF thread. And I had to have the right tap. And that goes on the retreat. It's a bit rough, just done in a hurry, but I'll tidy that up and give it a chemical black treatment before I fit it. So there we are, coming along. Hope you've enjoyed the video, and thank you very much for watching.